Welcome and thank you for joining us today for this very important webinar. My name is Gail Hargrave and I am the Assistant Project Director for CDI. I am joined today by Bridget Smith. Bridget, would you introduce yourself, please?
Sure, Gail. As Gail said, my name is Bridget Smith and I'm a Senior Project Manager for CDI. My focus is on active supervision, health, and safety, so this topic is so important to me. As you know, the health and safety of children and staff is a primary focus of every CDI Head Start and Early Head Start program. Today, we'll discuss what every CDI Head Start employee should do to make sure our centers are the safest places for children to learn and families to grow.
Let's talk about who is responsible for ensuring indoor and outdoor environments meet all health and safety standards. So let's do a quick poll to start us off. So who do you think is responsible? The facilities manager? The center directors? The project director? So I'm going to give you a couple of seconds to think about that. Well, the answer is everyone. Everyone in the program is responsible and should be safety aware at all times. It takes all eyes and hands on deck to be sure our environments are clean, well-maintained, and that repairs of replacement of equipment and materials is done as timely as possible.
The vision of CDI Head Start is that all of our environments are clean, safe, and free of hazards. This is important because we're focused on implementing local monitoring, and it's important that all staff have knowledge and skills to do that monitoring and understand what a safe environment looks like. We also promote a culture of safety, which means everyone feels responsible for the safety of our buses, playgrounds, facilities, and is always looking for things that come up.
The latest data available from fiscal year 2014 shows that of 465 grantees with findings, 58 or 13% were non-compliances or deficiencies associated with safe environments. This percentage has reduced from 44% since 2010 because of the focus the Office of Head Start has placed on this area, but it is still one of the areas with the most findings overall. It is important that CDI Head Start programs provide a great example of how to provide and maintain safe and healthy environments so the community continues to learn from our practices.
So now let's talk about our agenda. This webinar includes two parts. Part one is about indoor environments, and part two focuses on outdoor environments. For part one, we will review the Head Start performance standards related to health and safety for indoor environments. You'll hear us make some references to Caring for Our Children basics because those regulations are now embedded into the performance standards in this area. You'll also review a video with a guided health and safety walkthrough so you can see examples of what to look for as you complete health and safety checks in your centers. We hope you'll gain some insights into the types of things you should look for that help you implement the checklist more effectively as a local monitoring tool. We'll also ask you to pause the webinar a few times so you can have discussion and reflection time at your program. You should use that time to go over what you've heard and discuss it as a team to ensure everyone understands isn't on the same page.
Part two will follow the same structure. We will focus on the outdoor environment. It will also include a more in-depth review of the Head Start monitoring tool. The tool was included in the documents you received for this presentation.
So since health and safety is everyone's business, we expect everyone to participate in this session. It's everybody's responsibility, so everyone participates. Each program should already have a plan for rolling out this training to staff, so be sure to follow that plan. And incorporate anything else you want to share with your team that's specific to your local program. We've also included several opportunities for you to pause, reflect, and discuss what you're learning. You can do this in a small group training setting. We recommend you have small groups and will prompt you throughout the webinar to have discussions with your team.
There are some materials you will need for this training to be most successful when you introduce it into your program. First, everyone attending should already have completed their pre-work assignment and have that to refer to and reflect on during these discussions. You will need copies of the health and safety monitoring tool for every participant, and we will refer to this tool several times during the webinar. You may also want to print out a copy of the slides in the note page format so everyone can make notes for follow-up during the session and afterwards. If you have any questions about the content or materials, please contact us. We've included our email addresses on the slide here. If you run into any technical difficulties with the webinar, please reach out to our IS team, and their email is also included on this slide.
Okay, so let's dive into the performance standards. So this section is divided into three sections: cleanliness and safety, emergency precautions, and health practices. Before we get started, I want to point out the yellow sticky note on this slide. Remember, sometimes your state licensing standards are more stringent than the Head Start program performance standards. If that's the case, you always need to follow the more stringent requirement. Also, you'll notice as we go along, some of the slides include a reference to Caring for Our Children Basics regulations. These are now embedded as part of the new performance standards. So the first slide here shows a reference to 1302.47A. This is the overarching standard for cleanliness and safety in the new performance standards. And it says the program must establish, train staff on, implement, and enforce a system of the health and safety practices that ensure children are kept safe at all times. A program should consult Caring for Our Children Basics for additional information to develop and implement adequate safety policies and practices described in this part. And we put a reference to where you can find Caring for Our Children Basics here, so you can look that up and use it as a resource. This is an important slide for a lot of reasons, mostly because it really points out the systemic nature of this area of the performance standards and the focus on that now. You see, it starts right out by saying you have to establish a system of health and safety practices. So it's not anymore just complying with each of the minute requirements of the performance standards, but it's that the Office of Head Start wants you to create a system that is really comprehensive and covers all areas of health and safety in your program. Okay, so some of the new performance standards look very much the same as what you're used to, and this is one of those. 1302.21D2 says centers must have at least 35 square feet of usable indoor space per child available for the care and use of children, and that's exclusive of bathrooms, halls, kitchens, staff rooms, and storage places, and at least 75 square feet of usable outdoor space, play space per child. So some of the things we've run into when we go and visit programs is that people are not really sure about what usable space means. So I kind of want to define that for you here. So any areas that are not for children, such as staff desks or storage areas, need to be deducted from your square footage because those are not spaces used for the care and use of children. So when you think of usable space, it's any space that children are using, playing in, sleeping in, et cetera. You deduct anything that teachers are using or staff are using. So hopefully that'll help. And 75 square feet of usable outdoor play space per child means just that. Most of our playgrounds are open and available for children at all times. So most of our programs can just measure their full playground. If you have any questions about this, make sure to reach out to your program director, site manager. We have a lot of resources at CDI to help you with this as well in our facilities department.
Bridget, I'd like to add on that one is that if any program is taking more than one classroom out on the playground at a time, they have to remember that playground has to have adequate square footage for the number of children they're taking out, just not for one classroom.
Oh, yeah, that's so important, Gail. And we do see that sometimes where multiple classrooms go out at the same time. So you need to be really careful about that. If you determine you're going to take two or more classrooms out, make sure that space is sufficient. Thanks for that reminder, Gail. Very important. So this slide talks about, again, implementing a system of management, including ongoing training, oversight, correction, and continuous improvement in accordance with 1302.102 that includes policies and practices to ensure all facilities, equipment, and materials, background checks, safety training, safety and hygiene practices, and administrative safety procedures are adequate to ensure child safety. And this is 1302.47B1, I through IX. Again, you notice that there's a real focus on systems here, and training is part of an overall system. So I just want to highlight here that it's important that as you're training all of your staff, that everyone understands these regulations. It's not, as Gail stated at the beginning, that just the facilities manager's responsibility or the center director or the program director, it's everyone. So this goes on to say under number one, all facilities where children are served, including areas for learning, playing, sleeping, toileting, and eating, are at a minimum meeting licensing requirements in accordance with 1302.21D1 and 1302.23D. So we talked about earlier in the presentation the importance of knowing your licensing standard if you're running licensed centers. Whatever is the most stringent is what you follow. The change in the performance standards, though, is that now all Head Start programs are required to meet licensing standards, even if they're not licensed. And that's the reference to 1302.21. So be sure that you read all of the standards, because sometimes when we read them in isolation, we see these references. It's so important to go back and take a look at what they say, too. Okay, so 1302.47B1, 2, and 3 say that all of our areas must be clean and free from pests, and also free from pollutants, hazards, and toxins that are accessible to children and could endanger their safety. So this is one of the areas, as we went back and researched findings, that we saw a lot of issues in across the country, because it seems that some toxins are not clear to folks. And you'll see this during the video that we're going to watch in a little bit as part of this presentation, that sometimes things that you think are innocent are actually toxic to children. And those things include staff purses and backpacks that may include chemicals such as hand sanitizer that's not safe for children, or hairspray, or other things that you sit your purse down and you think that it's a safe place to put it. And before we know it, we know young children, and they'll get in there and they'll be accessing things that are not safe. So make sure you put those purses and backpacks up out of the reach of children too. It's not just bottles of chemicals we're talking about here. The other thing we've seen a lot of is hand soap that actually says on the back, keep out of the reach of children. So you need to make sure whatever hand soap you're using in your program is safe for children's use and can be left within their reach before you leave it on the back of a sink or anywhere else in the classroom. 1302.47B14 says, designed to prevent child injury and free from hazards, including choking, strangulation, electrical, and drowning hazards, hazards posed by appliances, and all other safety hazards. So you may know right away that this new regulation in the new performance standards is quite a bit different from the old one, because what the Office of Head Start did in these new regulations is combine some of the family child care regulations into the overall health and safety regs. So you'll notice here there's references to drowning hazards, hazards posed by appliances, et cetera, that used to be really specific to family child care homes. Now they are overarching regulations for all settings, including family child care homes. So that was one thing the Office of Head Start determined they could do to streamline the regulations for all options, and you'll notice that here. It's really helpful to us as well, because now we know that those regulations related to appliances, drowning hazards, et cetera, do apply to all of our centers, our home-based option, everywhere. So there's really that clarified that the regulation applies to all settings. Okay, and this slide is 1302.47B1V through VII, and those specific regulations say rooms must be well lit, including emergency lighting, must be equipped with safety supplies that are readily accessible to staff, including at a minimum, fully equipped and up-to-date first aid kits and appropriate fire safety supplies. and must be free from firearms or other weapons that are accessible to children. So here again, you see a combination of the family child care regulation into the overarching. I want to just say here that as we've been going out and doing visits in our programs, we find quite a bit that first aid kits are in place, but many times they're not up to date. And by up to date, I mean someone used supplies out of those and either they weren't monitored and replaced or, you know, the kit didn't have what it needed in the first place. And we've also found some things that are inappropriate in first aid kits. So you need to check with your health advisory committee to find out what they recommend. Your health manager should also be aware of what first aid kits should include for young children. And we have a lot of resources at CDI that can help as well on our health team. So make sure you reach out to your site manager and they can contact a program development associate to provide guidance on what those kits should include. It's also really important as you're doing your monthly monitoring using the health and safety checklist that you check those first aid kits really carefully, make sure they're stocked and they don't include anything that's inappropriate. The other thing is make sure you're checking dates on anything that has expiration dates. So, Gail, did you want to add anything there?
Sure. A couple of things. Let me go ahead and add some ideas on first aid kits. Even though it's not listed here, we want to make sure we're continuing to keep the first aid kits out of reach of children. Yeah. That way they're not in there and going through the first aid kit. Just some examples of what I have found over the years in first aid kits that were not appropriate items. I found lipstick. I found perfume. I found rocks. I found actually used tissues in the first aid kit. So just make sure you're really doing those monitoring checks and making sure that you only have in the first aid kit the items that are appropriate and are on the list that are to be included. The other thing I wanted to say is about emergency lighting. We always have the question, what is emergency lighting? Well, according to the performance standards, emergency lighting, it doesn't say it has to be one thing or the other. So the least thing it could be was a flashlight. But now, if you have a flashlight for emergency lighting, it has to have batteries that are operable. You can't have a flashlight with dead batteries, and I found that many times. So you must be checking those flashlights periodically. You can have lighted emergencies lights on the wall. That's also, you know, another way. One is not preferable over the other unless there is a child care licensing regulation or a building code that is more stringent than the performance standards. So I think that's all I'd like to add there, Bridget.
Okay, great. Those are great additions. Thanks, Gail. And yeah, you know, the other thing that brought to my mind was a lot of our programs are using backpacks to take out for first aid kits on the playground. And when you do that, it's really important to remember Gail's advice about checking those often, because I was at a program recently where there was a lot of things in that backpack that was not first aid. So what would happen if there was an emergency is staff would really have to search through that backpack to find the supplies they needed. And we don't want it to take a lot of time for staff to find supplies. That's the point of having it readily accessible. So thanks a lot, Gail. Okay, so this next one is pretty self-explanatory, but I've had questions about it, so we included it. 130247BA8 says that every space must be designed to separate toileting and diapering areas from areas for preparing food, cooking, or children's activities. So this comes up a lot in early Head Start classrooms, especially. A lot of our Head Start classrooms, the bathrooms are located outside the classroom. But in early Head Start, we have several classrooms that the bathrooms are located inside the classroom, as well as changing tables are located inside the classroom. And it's really important if you have changing tables inside the classroom or your toilet is accessible that you think about that when you have a food preparation area in your room as well. And early Head Start, we know you're preparing bottles, you're preparing baby food, and a lot of times that's on a counter area. You need to think about where you place your changing tables in that case. because recently I was at a program where one of the changing tables was right up next to the counter where I saw staff preparing bottles, and I mentioned that right away. There's such an issue with cross-contamination when you do that. So, and it's also not complying with this performance standard. So make sure you think about that. Children's activities such as a table for playing right next to a changing table is not acceptable either. So, you know, just think about that as you're laying out your classrooms. Okay, 1302.47b(a)(1)(x) says kept safe through an ongoing system of preventive maintenance. So what is an ongoing system of preventive maintenance? Is it just once a day walking through the classrooms and using a broom? Is it once a month? Is it once a week? Well, in my mind, ongoing system of preventive maintenance means everyone is looking all the time to make sure that every area where our children and staff are located is clean and safe. And also, if something comes up, it's not just the teacher's responsibility to mention that they have something broken in their classroom. It's everyone's responsibility. So as a center director, if you're walking through your center in the morning to check the health and safety, which hopefully you are, you're looking for a lot of different things. But one of those is anything that needs to be reported to your facility staff to be fixed. And this can be anything from a cabinet door to a tile that's broken or missing to, you know, you notice that a bathroom isn't as clean as it should be. All of those things need to be reported immediately because the goal is to have safe and clean environments 24/7. So that's the focus on everyone being a part of the system of health and safety, is that it doesn't mean that the only people that can report things are teachers or the cook in the kitchen or the bus driver on the bus. It's every single person in our programs looking at every environment as they walk through and reporting things that need to be cleaned or fixed to the appropriate staff. Gail, did you want to add anything there?
No, I think you covered everything I was thinking. So
great. All right. Okay, so 1302.47b2 says equipment and materials. So this focuses on equipment and materials as opposed to just the classrooms and the settings overall. And it says indoor and outdoor play equipment, cribs, cots, feeding chairs, strollers, and other equipment used in the care of enrolled children, and as applicable, other equipment and materials meet standards set by the Consumer Product Safety Commission or the American Society for Testing and Materials International. All equipment and materials must, at a minimum, be clean and safe for children's use and appropriately disinfected, sorry about that, be accessible only to children for whom they are age appropriate, be designed to ensure appropriate supervision of children at all times, allow for the separation of infants and toddlers from preschoolers during play in center-based programs, and be kept safe through an ongoing system of preventive maintenance. So this is a combination of a lot of requirements. And the reason I put it all on one slide is that you'll notice that some of the, what we used to think of as early Head Start specific regulations are now incorporated overall into the overarching B2 and the, also in the specifics below. And again, the Office of Head Start thought it was important to take a 0-5 approach in these regulations, and this is one that you'll notice that it mentions all equipment, including cribs, cots, feeding chairs, strollers, et cetera, that we would normally think of as being present in mostly early Head Start centers. And now it's part of the overarching standard. So that's important. So, and again, there's an emphasis on a system instead of just the minute regulation or requirement. Everything is systemic, and we're looking at it as a summary of what we're looking for in all of our centers. The other thing I want to note here is CPSC and ASTM are part of the regulation now. So that's new. We always in the past heard from the Office of Head Start that CPSC for outdoor environments was really important for the playground safety handbook. But this is the first time we're seeing it actually included as part of the regulations and requirements. So we provide a link to that at the end of this session. And we would really encourage everyone to take a look at that website and also at the handbook in the outdoor session, because you're now required to follow those standards. So.
And I would like to add here, Bridget, a couple of the specifics at the bottom of the slide. So when it says that the environment should be appropriately disinfected, that was going to be different for Head Start and early Head Start, because early Head Start, as we know, that toddlers are going to be putting things in their mouth more. So the schedule or the system for disinfecting early Head Start materials and equipment is very different from Head Start. So just keep that in mind when you're looking at those schedules and making a system for that. The other thing I want to point out is Roman numeral 3, that your equipment and materials need to be designed where you can supervise children at all times. And so, you know, if you have a preschool classroom and you have really tall shelves that are 4 feet or higher, it could be difficult to see over those in order to supervise the room at all times. That also means nap time has to be supervised. That's not a time for teachers to take their mind off the children and do other things, such as, you know, paperwork, working on the computer. I know sometimes we sit with the children and we can work on those things, but our first and foremost priority is at nap time is still supervising the children. So.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Gail. And that brings up another good point about that specific standard. So we have a whole other training on active supervision, but this is one of the tenets of active supervision, is that you design your environment so that it's easy to supervise children. And Gail mentioned tall furniture, and that's something that we saw quite a bit at our programs this year. And just making sure that you place taller furniture up against the walls where it's not blocking your sight is really important. So that's an important consideration for sure. And again, I want to point out to folks the last item, Roman numeral number 5, says be kept through an ongoing system of preventive maintenance. So it's mentioned there again. It's mentioned several times in the regulations. So. Okay. 130247B4IB says staff with regular child contact. All staff with regular child contact have initial orientation training within 3 months of hire and ongoing training in all state, local, tribal, federal, and program-developed health, safety, and child care requirements to ensure the safety of children in their care, including at a minimum and as appropriate based on staff roles and ages of children they work with, training in prevention of sudden infant death syndrome and use of safe sleeping practices. And then you'll also see 130247B52 mentions under safety practices, all staffing consultants follow appropriate practices to keep children safe during all activities, including at a minimum safe sleep practices, including ensuring that all sleeping arrangements for children under 18 months of age use firm mattresses or cots as appropriate, and for children under 12 months, soft bedding materials or toys must not be used. And the reason I included both of these regulations on this slide is that in many areas of the new performance standards, you'll see where there are cross-cutting regulations, and this is one of them. There's a training regulation specifically around sudden infant death syndrome, and the requirement that folks are trained in it within 3 months. So that's great. And it also mentions safe sleeping practices and defines them right in the regulation under 130247. And that way you don't have to guess what age can we use blankets, you know, when are children supposed to sleep on their back. Everything is defined right there for you. If you provide a really good training in safe sleep, then your staff is ready to execute these procedures. And I'm going to just ask everyone to think about, is it important for all of your staff to know and understand safe sleeping practices? Or is it okay if just your early Head Start teachers are aware of those things? And you can discuss that in a minute, but I want to tell you what I think. I think that anyone that walks into an early Head Start classroom should be able to see children sleeping in cribs and make sure that they're safe. And that includes everyone from the cook that walks through and brings in food, the center director that stops by to monitor, the bus driver that comes in after a transportation route to help. you can see how, you know, everyone in your center should be aware of safe sleeping practices, because we fill in for each other in Head Start programs sometimes. So when we only train direct caregivers, like our early Head Start teachers, that's a missing, because you might have someone subbing, you might have someone step into the classroom who needs to understand that children need to sleep on their back to be safe, that we don't use fluffy bedding or blankets or toys for children under 12 months. Everyone needs to know this, because there is a risk of sudden infant death syndrome in our programs, and we can help minimize that risk by training everyone. So that's what I have to say about that. It's very important. Okay, so this is your first pause and reflect opportunity. Please pause the webinar and discuss the two questions on this slide for the first section we just covered, cleanliness and safety. Talk about your pre-work and if your interpretation of the standards were the same or different than what you just heard. What do you think now? Also, now that you understand it is everyone's responsibility to monitor for clean and safe environments, how does this change the way you view your role related to these standards? Take about 10 minutes and be sure to report out to each other and discuss.
This section includes slides 22 through 27, and we're going to follow along with the monitoring tool and explain each standard, then modify the monitoring language if necessary. And just again, there's the sticky note about to know your child care licensing regulations to ensure that we're including what is most stringent and following the most stringent.
Okay, great. Thanks, Gail. So this is the first slide where we see a reference to caring for our children basics directly. And again, these are embedded into the performance standards now. So when we were looking up the regulations for this session, what we found was that some of the things that we think about in the old performance standards have now been replaced by the caring for our children regulations. And this is one of them. So caring for our children 9.4.1.16 says evacuation and shelter in place drill record. A record of evacuation drills, shelter in place drills, lockdown drills, and of facility participation in community evacuation drills should be kept on file. The type of drill, the date, and the time should be recorded. So this is a requirement in our programs that we do fire drills and tornado drills, and that they are recorded on a form. And so you should already be familiar with that. You should make sure that you're doing that. The interesting thing about this requirement is that the shelter-in-place drills have been added, lockdown drills have been added. So it's important for you to address those as well to comply with caring for our children basics. The one thing I do want to point out about these regulations is that in a lot of these, the caring for our children references, you'll see it'll say should be recorded. But when we read something like that in Head Start performance standards, it will usually say must. And I want to say that in our programs, we want everyone to be as safe as possible. So we do require that you record your drills and any other evacuations that you conduct. And that includes off of buses. So that's important. When you see the word should here, I want to change that word in your mind to must. And I wanted to point that out. And remember that these need to be done at least monthly, and record them on Form 570, and you can find that on the extranet. Okay, so caring for our children 5.1.4.1 says alternate access and emergency shelter. Each building or structure, new or old, should be provided with a minimum of two exits, at different sides of the building or home, leading to an open space at ground level. If the basement in a small family childcare home is being used, one exit must lead directly to the outside. Exit should be unobstructed, allowing occupants to escape to an outside door or exit stair enclosure in case of fire or other emergency. Each floor above or below ground level used for childcare should have at least two unobstructed exits that lead to an open area at ground level and thereafter to an area that meets safety requirements for a childcare indoor or outdoor area. Children should remain there until their parents' guardians can pick them up if reentry into the facility is not possible. Entrance and exit routes should be reviewed and approved by the applicable fire inspector. Exiting should meet all the requirements of the current edition of the NFPA 101 Life Safety Code from the National Fire Protection Association. So this is very specific, and you'll notice in the past, the Head Start performance standards basically said you needed to have posted evacuation and exit routes or exit signs, and you needed to have evacuation drills and all of that. But this caring for our children makes it much more specific about what's required around exits, where they're located, if it's a family childcare home, especially if it's in a basement, what you have to have, things like that. So it's a great resource regulation because it gives you a lot of specific information. The one thing I want to point out on here is that they really do recommend that you have your fire inspector take a look at your evacuation route. And all of our programs are inspected. And so that would be a great time to just ask your fire inspector to take a look at your posted evacuation routes and where your exits are located and make sure they're the safest they can possibly be. You also want to think about where you're having your teachers and children meet outside and make sure that it's an open area, that it is away from the building, all the things that are listed here. So just kind of reevaluate how you're evacuating for fire drills and also where you're locating your tornado drill meeting areas inside the building and make sure that you review those and take a look at this regulation. Gail, did you have anything you wanted to add there?
I don't. I think you've covered it.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, so you'll see that under emergency precautions section, we've listed this rooms are well lit, including emergency lighting again. There's a reason for that. I wanted to point out that even in the specific standards that are now located in the performance standards, they cross-cut into different areas. So we looked at that in the first section as part of maintaining facilities, keeping them clean and safe, but it's also part of the emergency precautions piece of the session for a reason, because including emergency lighting in classrooms is not just a requirement for maintenance, it's also a requirement to make sure that if you have to get out of a classroom quickly, that's possible for your staff. There's a lot of research that shows that if emergency lighting is in place during an emergency drill or an actual emergency, lives are saved. So there's a reason for emergency lighting. It's not just something you want to check off on a list. It's something that is vital. And when Gail was mentioning the dead batteries in flashlights earlier, it really resonated with me because we do find that a lot, that we are using flashlights as emergency lighting, which is perfectly fine. But when we go to monitor and we pick one up and it's not working, it always makes me think, what would happen if this was an actual emergency? So, you know, sometimes we get to where we're looking at health and safety as just something that we have to do because it's on a checklist. And I want to get people out of that mindset. It's so much more than that. It's about the safety of our children and staff in the centers and our parents. So, you know, really start to think about this as an emergency precaution, not just something you have to check off the checklist. Okay, and here we make another reference to the first aid kits for the same reason, because they are a big part of helping us get through emergency situations. If first aid kits are well stocked, accessible to staff, then it's a lot more likely that we're going to be able to help a child or anyone in the center who needs it. And if we open a kit and it's not fully equipped up to date, then we have a big problem. because it slows down our response time. And so I wanted to make sure we touched on this again. And the other thing I want to point out here is that safety supplies also includes things like your fire safety equipment. So checking your smoke detectors is really important, making sure all of your fire extinguishers are charged and up to date. All of that is part of this regulation and requirement. Okay, so it's time to pause again. Please discuss the two questions on this slide as a team and document your responses on a flip chart or whatever way you'd like to do it so you have it to refer to later. And the questions are, how do these explanations of emergency precaution standards align with your pre-work interpretations of the standards? How do they differ? And now that you understand it is everyone's responsibility to monitor emergency precautions, how does this change the way you view your role related to the standards? So we're going to pause and let you reflect. Okay, and we're going to move on with the presentation. This section explains the rest of the standards in this area, and I want to give one more reminder to folks. Know your child care licensing regulations. Are they more stringent? And we're going to talk about health practices in this section. So 1302.47b6 is about hygiene practices. All staff systemically and routinely implement hygiene practices that are at a minimum ensure appropriate toileting, hand washing, and diapering procedures are followed, safe food preparation, and exposure to blood and body fluids are handled consistent with standards of the Occupational Safety Health Administration, or OSHA. So let's stop there for a second. We do require specific hygiene practices, especially during diapering. And when we go out to centers, we look for diapering procedures to make sure that staff are trained on them. We watch staff while they're diapering to make sure they're following those. That's so important, and especially as we're getting into cold and flu season in the fall, all of that, this is a great way to stop the spread of germs. And we want to protect our children, but we also want to protect our staff and keep them healthy so that we don't run into incidents of staff attendance and things like that. So diapering procedures may seem like just another thing you do, but it's something that can really keep our centers safe and healthy. So you'll see toileting, hand washing listed there too. On a recent observation that I did, I noticed that staff were not always having children wash their hands after they blew their noses. And so I want to point that out is a time where we do require hand washing. Children blow their nose, they need to go wash their hands, and the same for staff. That's another way to stop the spread of germs and communicable diseases. So thanks for doing that. Safe food preparation. We have a whole training around safe food preparation that we do with our cooks, and we follow the CACFP requirements, and so that will be provided. But this can also mean safe food preparation for snacks if you're preparing snacks in the classroom, which sometimes we need to do that, or you're doing a cooking activity with children. So all of our staff need to be familiar with safe food preparation. And we do follow the OSHA requirements related to blood and body fluids, and we have a whole training on that as well that you'll receive as part of our program trainings. 1302.47b7.3 says administrative safety procedures. Programs establish, follow, and practice as appropriate procedures for, at a minimum, protection from contagious disease, including appropriate inclusion and exclusion policies for when a child is ill, and from an infectious disease outbreak, including appropriate notifications of any reportable illness. So the regulation does require that if we have a child who's in the center who is ill, that we take a look at that child, and if they're running a fever or anything like that, it's probably better to exclude them. And I know our local programs have established policies around this. Some of our programs have sick rooms where they take children while they wait for their parents to come and pick them up, things like that. And that's all good practice. The one thing I do want to point out about this is that appropriate notifications of reportable illness is really important. If you have a child who is very ill, bring something to school that is very contagious, we do ask our programs to report that to parents at the center. And that can be just an overarching letter to let folks know we have a flu outbreak at the center or whatever it is, so that they're aware and they can watch their children and make sure that they protect their families as well through hand washing and all of the things. So this is a great opportunity to also educate our parents about contagious illness if something like this happens. And so you should take advantage of those opportunities when they come up. Gail, was there anything you wanted to add here?
Nope, I think you covered it.
Great. All right, so 1302.47b7 says programs establish, follow, and practice as appropriate procedures for, at a minimum, the handling, storage, administration, and record of administration of medication. So we have many required forms around this regulation, including parent authorization, number 598 and 1228, medication logs, 599, 1227. And we also require specific procedures at every program around how you're going to handle storage and administer medication to children. This is an area that can be high risk for programs. We want to always make sure that all of our staff are aware of and can follow the procedures, and that we have someone who is designated on site at centers to provide medication to children, and that they are trained before they do so. It's so important, because the last thing we want to do is give a child the wrong medication or an expired medication if it's an emergency medication especially. I just can't stress how important it is to monitor carefully this area and to administer medications correctly every single time. The one thing that we see a lot is expired medication when we go out to look for this at our programs, and that is actually another one of the major findings across the country. So when you're monitoring on a monthly basis, or even more often, hopefully, please take a look at children's medications and make sure they're within the expiration date. This is so important, especially for children with asthma who have rescue inhalers, for children who could go into anaphylactic shock if they have an EpiPen that is out of date, all of those things. So again, this is not just an IMNA checklist. It can be a matter of really severe health issues for children. So I wanted to emphasize this slide. Okay, 1302.47b18 says all facilities where children are served, including areas for learning, playing, sleeping, toileting, and eating, are at a minimum designed to separate toileting and diapering areas from areas for preparing food, cooking, eating, or children's activities. And so we just wanted to mention again here with a picture of an early Head Start classroom. And if you look at this picture, you'll see that the sink and the changing table are close to each other, but you don't see anything where food is being prepared or any child play area, actually. Looks like there's a storage area for cots. There's looks like a water fountain in the background, but that's pretty far away from that area. So this classroom setup was correct, and it's separating those areas that we talked about earlier. Okay, and 1302.47b2i says equipment and materials, indoor and outdoor play equipment, cribs, cots, feeding chairs, et cetera, must be clean and safe for children's use and are appropriately disinfected. So this is another one of those cross-cutting standards that fit under health practices as well as maintenance and cleanliness. So we wanted to list it again here just to remind you that it's not just something on a checklist that we're doing. This is keeping this little boy and all other children in our programs healthy and safe. Okay, and all of our procedures are followed like we talked about before. And here we'd like to pause and discuss again, how do these explanations of health practices standards align with your pre-work interpretations of the standards? How do they differ? And now that you understand it's everyone's responsibility to monitor health practices, how does this change the way you view your role related to these standards? So let's pause for a minute and we'll come back. Okay, so now we're going to play a video that shows a typical indoor health and safety check. As you watch the video, think about the following questions. What was identified as a hazard that you may have thought was safe for children before? Did you see anything else in the video that you would have found and reported that was not discussed? And you may recognize the person who's doing this health and safety check, so see if you can note that as well.
Welcome to CDI Head Start's Health and Safety Training Video. My name is Gail Hardgrave. The health and safety of all facilities is a major concern for CDI Head Start. Health and safety is a major reason that Head Start programs across the country are out of compliance with the performance standards. And because teachers, staff, and others are in the program on a daily basis, it's often overlooked, but crucial for everyone to be alert. Health and safety is everyone's business. Now let's begin our walkthrough. Here I find some coffee sitting at the computer, which is in reach of children, which is a hazard. Here is staff's purses, and this is a safety hazard. There may be things that are keep out of reach of children, medication, items in purse that would be a danger to children. This here is tape residue that it happens when we use clear tape to put labels on the furniture, and so it needs to be cleaned off or it will have a cleaner appearance. Here is some air freshener that needs to be kept out of reach of children because it could be sprayed into their eyes and it would be dangerous. This is under the sink, and there's no lock on it, and when you open it, the first thing I saw was a bottle of bleach, which is very toxic. Should be kept under lock and key and out of reach of children. Here's a bottle of hand sanitizer, which also needs to be kept out of reach of children. It's made up of mostly alcohol. Over here in the corner, you'll see a dirty backpack, but this is their first aid kit, which is required to be out of reach of children, and obviously it is not. And then this area here, it's just full of clutter. There's boxes, there's paper, and there's not anything on the shelf, so I'm not sure the purpose of this area. This is emergency medications for children with emergency conditions. It looks like an EpiPen, and this can be unlocked, but it needs to be stored out of reach of children, which this is, so it's a good example of where to keep emergency medication. So here in the restroom, on the bottom of the toilet, there's a rusty exposed bolt, which is a hazard to children. Also, this toilet has not been flushed, so it's not clean and sanitary. Over here in the corner, we have a large box of blocks sitting on top of a shelf, which is a danger of falling on children when they're here in the restroom. Also, we have a mop that has been used obviously for mopping, and it's dirty, so shouldn't be in here where children can be exposed to it. So here I found this bottle of Whiteout here on this teacher shelf in reach of children, and on the back it specifically says keep out of reach of children. And then this area here, it looks like the teacher's area, but it seems to have a lot of clutter that we may want to straighten up and clean out. For non-emergency medication, it must be in a box with a lock. So this is a good example of a place to store medication that is not emergency. This is the box has a lock right here, and the key is kept in a different location. So this evacuation route shows the path to exit the building, which is required by the performance standards. Here we have an example of the Head Start Daily Health and Safety Checklist, and it's to be completed every day. And if you notice, here's a date of August 19th to the 23rd, and then here we have nothing documented for today. Here's an example of a power strip that does not have any plug covers as required by the performance standards. Here we have their toothbrush and toothpaste holders. As you can see, it holds each child's toothbrush and toothpaste. However, toothpaste must be kept out of the reach of children at all times. So here we have a stack of boxes that are just taking up space that the children could use, and they just need to be taken out. A couple of them are empty, so this just needs to be cleaned up. So what we're going to do now is go through the contents of this first aid kit. So in this first aid kit, we have a disposable cleanup kit. We have non-adhesive pads, baggies, eye patch, scissors, safety pins, emergency guide, cotton balls, goggles, temperature thermometer, Band-Aids and square sterile pads, rolled gauze, first aid tape, more Band-Aids, cold pack, triangular bandage, more cotton balls. All right, let's see what's in this one. This zipper compartment, we have the first aid kit list that is approved for use in our programs. And in this last zipper compartment, we have our latex gloves. These are all appropriate supplies for the first aid kit. But what I found in the past, things that were inappropriate for first aid kits, I found nail polish, I found rocks, I found dirty used Kleenexes. I've found hairspray, makeup, medication that was expired that shouldn't have even been in there. I found Tylenol and many other miscellaneous things. So you want to make sure you stick to the first aid kit list that's approved for use at your center. All right, you'll notice here on this emergency exit door at the bottom, there's a metal strip that's come loose, and that's sharp and dangerous to children. So you can see here the blinds that are in the room, they are really coated with dust, and so they need to be cleaned on a regular basis. These two items were found stored on top of the children's cubbies, which are hazardous to children and should be kept out of their reach. So the top of the cubbies is not a place for us to store items that are teachers' materials. Those need to be put up out of reach of children. So here we found a trash can after the children have left for the day. It contains food items, which must be in a can with a lid. So this is not proper storage of trash and garbage. So here's a good example of computer wires that are hanging down in reach of children. So that is dangerous of them pulling off the equipment from the computer desk. So here we are in an early Head Start classroom doing the health and safety check, and here is their indoor first aid kit. So we're going to open it up, see what we've got. Here they have their checklist that they complete each month, and it looks like this one is not up to date. So this is supposed to be done monthly, and this is a 2012-13, so we need to make sure we have an up-to-date checklist. This, I don't know what it is. I asked them, and it seems to be water. It's not on the list, so we're going to remove this out of the, because first of all, it's not marked, and it's not on the list, so we're going to take that out. Here's some gauze, Band-Aids, and then this is also something. This was a child's brush, which doesn't belong in the first aid kit, and this child isn't even here anymore, but it just doesn't need to be in here, so that needs to be taken out. We got goggles. Here's nail clippers. Those really are not on the list, and so we need to take those out. And it looks like all the other things are on the required list, so they will stay in the kits. So then if we look over here, here's the changing table, and they've got a good mat. It's got some sides on it. But when you look over here in the corner, you see that we have soap water, some bleach water, and some other bottles of water that they just have numbers on them. And then we have glue sticks and some other things that really need to be removed from this area. So these have to be removed because the baby could crawl off and get into these items. You notice this in this early Head Start classroom, they put some padding on the corners of the sink because the toddlers, it would be dangerous for those edges to be at their eye level. Here on this carpet, it looks like it needs vacuuming, but what we especially found was this. It's a piece of hard plastic with sharp edges that was on the floor, so we're gonna remove that. Okay, and then over in this area, there's a small loft, and it looks fine. I don't see any safety hazards with the loft. And then here's the small restroom area for the children. And this door is to the office area. That's not a problem. However, it's not always shut, and it's a heavy metal door, so children could get their fingers mashed. So here's the toothbrushes in a nice clean storage area out of reach of children, and right next to them is the toothpaste, also out of reach of children. Then next to this sink area is a soiled linen trash can or waste basket, and the top of it really needs to be cleaned, the tape removed, and a good scrubbing. And then here on the door that goes over to the next classroom, you can see there's some tape residue that we need to look at cleaning off of there. So here's a little sofa in the housekeeping area. As you can see, it's starting to wear and peel, so this will need to be replaced. Children can peel this off and put it in their mouth. So here's a plug in the restroom area for the toddlers that has no plug cover, and it is not a safety plug. Here is a sink out in the classroom for the children, and they are using antibacterial soap. For some brands of soap, on the back, it says keep out of reach of children. So when they purchase these brands, they do have to be kept out of reach, not by the sink. So here we're looking at the door entering the classroom with the early Head Start, and the paint is peeling on this metal frame, and also it's very dusty on the seal down here. Here's a mat that the toddlers and infants play on, and it looks pretty dirty. It needs a thorough cleaning to make sure it's sanitary for the children to play. Here's a trash can that they use in the classroom, and the trash can itself is okay, but it does need to be cleaned. The lid is quite dirty also. So here in front of the sink, it's missing a strip of formica. It also doesn't have the protective cushion on the corners like we've seen in the other classrooms for early Head Start. All right, so here's one of the toilets in the early Head Start classroom, and you can see it's badly stained, so we need to see if we can get some kind of chemicals or some scrub brush that can clean that up. And then here's the changing table. And you can see we have the bleach water in reach of the children that would be changing here. And there's lots of other clutter that we will need to remove. So here's the early Head Start fire drill and inspections form. And this one was completed August 15th. So they're up to date on their monthly fire drills. This is a good safety knob for a door that you have within the classroom, because you have to pinch it together before you can open it. And the children are not strong enough to do that, so it keeps things safe. So here we find the fire extinguisher, and the most important thing to look at is this tag that's put on. It's by the fire marshal, and this fire extinguisher was last inspected December 13th, 2012, and that inspection is good for 1 year. So this is a fire extinguisher that is in good condition. But what I found in here was a package of screws which is accessible to children, which is a safety hazard, so we will need to remove those. This fire extinguisher at the center here is stored in the hall, which is acceptable. The performance standards state that the fire extinguisher must be easily accessible to staff, which this is. It does not require that it's mounted inside the classroom. The fire and safety checklist, document 570, is to be completed each month. This documents the smoke detectors and fire alarms are in working condition. It also documents that the evacuation plans have been practiced monthly. So here's the posted policy that shows that this facility is smoke-free. This building is equipped with emergency lighting such as this one. They're in every classroom and in the hallway. If your building does not have this type of emergency lighting, a flashlight will meet the performance standards. So here's an example of a clean water fountain that's in the hall. So you want to make sure that you're cleaning these daily and that they're acceptable for the health and safety of children. If the building is sprayed with pesticides or herbicides, there must be an MSDS sheet requested from the provider in case there are reactions by staff or children. So now we're in the kitchen at the center where they prepare the food for the children. And one thing I'm going to point out is these ladies that are preparing the snack and the lunch, they have gloves and they have their hairnets on, and so they are abiding by the health and safety guidelines. They also asked me to put on a hairnet before I entered the kitchen. Also, on the canned foods on the shelf, they have dates on them saying when they were bought and placed on the shelf, which is required by USDA. Also, they have a warming cabinet for the food to keep it warm, and it's at 183 degrees, which is above the danger zone for health and safety. So here in the kitchen, they have posted the allergies of the specific children. It has a cover sheet, making sure that confidentiality is kept. Underneath, there's a list of children and their specific allergies. So here we are in the cafeteria, and when you enter, you see that there are four exits, but there's only one evacuation route posted. So you want to make sure that there's one posted at each door. Here's a bucket of bleach water in the reach of children, which is a hazard and danger to children. So if you're going to use this, it needs to be kept out of children's reach. Okay, so here we are still in the cafeteria, and there are plugs on the wall. And even in the cafeteria, you must have the covers on the plugs. One of the requirements of the performance standards is for teachers and children to wash their hands before meals, after meals, many, many times. So refer to the performance standards for details, but proper hand washing is a requirement. So in addition to visiting the classroom and observing health and safety hazards, we need to ask the teachers and staff a couple of questions. One of those is how they dispose of hazardous waste. And I asked that question this morning, and the response was that the items are placed in a biohazard red bag. That's partially correct. For large amounts of spills, we use the red bags. They cannot be placed in the dumpster or trash at the center. They must be picked up by a professional company. But most cases in our centers, the amount of blood or bodily fluids is small. And under those circumstances, you may put the contaminated materials, gloves, papers, Band-Aids, into a plastic bag, secure it with a twist tie, and take it out to the dumpster. Just make sure that you don't put it in the trash can in the classroom. When monitoring your classrooms and playgrounds, remember to use the knowledge you gained from this video. A health and safety monitoring tool may be downloaded from the extranet for your use. Thank you for watching CDI Head Start's health and safety training video.
Okay, so I hope you enjoyed the video. It was very fun for me to make the video, so I hope you had some aha moments that we're going to discuss now. So if you'd now please pause the video and discuss the following questions. Number one, what were your aha moments from the video? Did anything surprise you? Number two, how have the video examples broadened your understanding of the Head Start performance standards related to health and safety? And number three, in what health and safety areas do you already know your program needs improvement?
Okay, so we hope you had a great discussion about the video and the in-depth health and safety check that Gail did for us, and I want to thank her for that. It was just great. So now we're going to look ahead a little bit. We This is the end of the first part of this webinar, and in the next part, we're going to discuss the outdoor environments and the regulations for those. And you'll have additional opportunity to discuss as a team when we pause, just like we did this time. We're also going to go and have a health and safety walkthrough again, a video that shows Gail, our superstar, walking through an outdoor area to show you some of the things that we would look for during those checks. And we're going to talk about using the health and safety monitoring tool in your programs in a little more detail and the requirement to do that. So that's what comes up next.